All right, party's over. Time to get back to work. After all, it is that time of day again here, folks. Wednesday evening, March the 11th, 2020. My name is Joseph, and as always, welcome back to your nightly newsletter. Now, if you're here for the first time, it's great to have you with me because my job tonight is to find the best levels of support and resistance for tomorrow, the best entry setups and targets for tomorrow, and most importantly, my job tonight is to help identify and capitalize on the biggest traps and opportunities to capitalize on those traps in tomorrow, that's Thursday's trading session. And we have a jam-packed video in store for you guys and gals tonight. The charts are all ready. As you can see in the background, we got some gold, some S&P, and of course, some crude oil. We're going to break these things down tonight and put together all the best setups I'm watching for tomorrow's trading session. And of course, I also want to grab the calendar tonight. We get some big news coming tomorrow, some rollover on our radar, and a lot of information I'm going to talk about as we go into quadruple witching next week. So I'm going to load the video up with lots of great information for you guys and gals tonight so we can make the most of our time together in tomorrow morning's trade room. Before we jump into the video tonight, though, please make sure to remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel. I don't want you to miss every evening's video newsletter, so make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. And don't forget, if you have any questions, drop those questions in the comment section below the video tonight. And as always, guys, I really appreciate you spending an hour with me every evening. If you tune in every evening and watch this video with me, hit that thumbs up button for me tonight, right? Thanks for showing the love here on this YouTube channel. So subscribe, drop those questions, and if you got them, hit that thumbs up button for me if you love the video tonight. But let's not waste any more valuable time. Time is ticking. Let's get the video tonight going. I want to take a look at the economic news calendar first to make sure we know what to be looking for here tomorrow. Let's grab the economic news calendar here courtesy of EconoDay. And let's get this party rolling here this evening. Tomorrow, of course, is Thursday, March the 12th. Now, we are going through this second week of the month. And as I keep reminding us, if it wasn't for the darn coronavirus, right, freaking everybody out right now, this would be probably a pretty quiet week. There isn't a lot of news on the schedule, right? Not a lot at the beginning of the week, right? We had that CPI number and the inventory report today. Tomorrow, we're going to have another one of those PPIs, right? This time, the producer price index. That's the big news report tomorrow morning on our radar. And anytime I have a CPI or a PPI, any of these inflation numbers, I'm always watching really anything tied to the US dollar. So currencies tomorrow morning, metals tomorrow morning. We'll get gold on our video tonight, so we'll definitely be looking for gold tomorrow morning in our trade room. 8:30 Eastern time is that big news. I'm not much of a natural gas trader, so I'm not going to worry about too much about that and get the balance sheet tomorrow afternoon. I don't think that'll be too big of a market moving event. We continue right now, we get some big news tomorrow at 8:30 Eastern time. We continue though to see the biggest moves right now after about 10:15, 10:30 Eastern time. You probably have noticed that. We're seeing a lot of chop and slop early in the session this week. And it's almost like once people kind of figure out what's going on, then we're starting to get those bigger moves as we go into the end of the morning. Now, that's just what's happened so far this week. We'll see if that continues tomorrow. We get some big news tomorrow morning at 8:30 Eastern time tomorrow. That should get us going. And then, of course, we'll keep our eyes open the entire session because just like today, we may have to wait a couple hours before we start seeing some clearing out of some of the ranges and some of the best opportunities. Now, don't forget, guys, we'll be together tomorrow morning and every morning in our trade room. And of course, we trade together every morning, 8:00 Eastern time. I'll put all the links, by the way, to join as a member. Come get registered. Come join me and trade with me every morning in our trade room. I'll put all the links for that registration information in the description of this YouTube video. If you're on the blog at Sideways Markets, I'll put a big blue button for you guys below the video tonight on the trading blog. I also want to remind you too that tomorrow we are watching rollover tomorrow. It's tough to tell when we're going to get rollover, if it's tomorrow or Friday, but the E-mini S&P, basically all of the E-minis, right? So NASDAQ, I'll be watching the S&P obviously. S&P, NASDAQ, Russell, Dow, we'll be watching those for rollover over the next couple days here. So Thursday, maybe we get rollover tomorrow. Probably not going to be tomorrow. It'll probably be on Friday, but every once in a while we get that kind of surprise. So be aware of that tomorrow. We are, of course, right now on the 0320 contract on the E-minis. once the volume on the 06-20 contract, right? Of course, we're on the March contract right now. We're almost at the end of the second week of March. That will roll over to the June contract, that 06-20 contract. It's pretty simple, right? Once the volume is higher, right, the total volume count on that 06-20 contract, we'll make the switch. That might be tomorrow. It's probably going to be on Friday. And obviously, we'll do it together tomorrow morning in our trade room with all of our members. I also want to give you a heads up for next week as well. Next week is the third week of the third month of the year. And of course, you may have heard me talk about this before. If you're a client of mine, you know all about this already, right? The third week of every 3 months, and then of course it's March, June, September, right, and December, is known as quadruple witching. The nasty one is usually that first one, that first third week of the third month, right? So 3, 6, 9. The first one is next week. Now, this is definitely a situation you can certainly trade this next week, but you've got to be aware you've got 4 different asset classes expiring at the end of the week next week. Historically, I take that week off in the afternoons to focus on clerical, stuff I'm working on here in the office, right? So third week of March, June, September, and December in my world as a professional trader are kind of marked as kind of housekeeping weeks. So next week, I will be working with clients in the morning, right? But I will not be publishing my afternoon newsletter every evening next week. So please be aware, I will come back tomorrow night, obviously, and do our tomorrow night newsletter for Friday's trading session, but there'll be no newsletter next week. I will be working with clients next week. However, I will not be publishing in the afternoons. Our newsletter will pick up where we left off in the fourth week of the month of March. So I always hate to leave you guys hanging, but every couple months, and I would encourage you to do something similar. Every couple months, make sure you kind of look back, reflect, regroup, reorganize. That's what I'll be doing in my office next week in the afternoon. So quick heads up on that, right? Again, we'll finish up tonight. Tomorrow as scheduled. Next week, no newsletter next week in observance, I guess you would say, right, of that quad witching holiday. And of course, tomorrow, as we go into the rest of the week, we continue to listen in to how this coronavirus is going to keep, affecting these markets. We definitely saw markets roll over right today, and it definitely feels like markets are a little bit out of air, out of breath, so to speak, right now. So we'll see how tomorrow, right, how much more headlines we keep getting. There wasn't a lot of new information today. We're going to hear from President Trump in the U.S., I believe at 9 o'clock Eastern time from the Oval Office tonight. But other than that, though, we didn't hear a lot of updates here for today. So quick recap here, big news tomorrow, right? The PPI number, be aware of the rollover on the E-minis, and again, no newsletter next week, right? That quad witching week, that third week of the third month of the year. All right, I apologize for that lengthy introduction. I wanted to make sure we got all the important housekeeping issues out of the way. I got charts all ready to go tonight for us, though. We got some oil, some S&P, and some gold. I'm going to jump first here, though, right in the middle here on the E-mini S&P 500. We got a bunch of different clues going on. There's a lot of really interesting learning and earning opportunities right now on this E-mini S&P. There's really a couple key components to this. The first one is this spike in channel. And spike in channel patterns, really, it's just a channel at this point, right? We've got a bear channel coming down. We can easily see we are bearish in this market right now. And a bear market tells me I want to sell at resistance. And so I'm trying to find levels of resistance. I always look for channels whenever I have a trending environment. And one thing stands out, you'll notice, right? It kind of pokes its head below that channel. Now, think of a channel, right? Think of a channel here like a, think of like a magnet right in the middle, right? And the pendulum swings below it, it's going to swing back above it. So I call these overshoots or pendulum swings. And right now we have an overshoot of the low of that channel. Now, if I draw a vertical line straight up ahead of me here and I pop that overshoot on top of me, that's going to give me a level of resistance overhead that I can count on tomorrow. Again, we're bearish, so I'm looking for levels of resistance. So one very interesting component of this chart is this bear channel, this overshoot, as we call it, the amount of the move underneath the channel. I'm going to pop it right to the high, right where we are right now. That will give me my overshoot, right, of the other side of that channel, and that creates a great level of resistance. That's one thing to keep in mind here for tomorrow. Again, we're bearish, trying to find levels of resistance. Another key component here, I have a little tiny range down here, you'll notice, right? Very tiny, tiny range. It looks a lot smaller than it really is. This is a 12,000 tick chart right now because we had so much volume today. You know, markets are adjusting to this coronavirus spook right now. But we know we have a range, and of course, ranges are very similar, right? Imagine there's a balance right in the middle. The amount of the move below it is the amount of the move above it. So what I'm doing is I'm actually taking the size of that range. I'm measuring the overshoot, or as I call a pendulum swing on a range, and projecting that back up overhead. That creates yet another level of resistance. So you can see here how these two pieces of the puzzle are kind of giving me a little sell zone up here, right? I'm kind of creating a range up here of areas of resistance. One is the pendulum swing, right, or the overshoot of the range. The other is the pendulum swing or the overshoot, right, of that channel. Now on top of that, I'm also watching this area right around this 2793. If I had to guess tomorrow, that would probably be where I would expect to see the most number of sellers, because you can see bounce, 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 comes back to it, bounce, right? They were loving on that level at 2793. I don't care what it is. I don't know what it is. It could be a pivot. It could be a fib level. It doesn't really matter to me. All I know is there's a lot of attention on that 93 area, and it's conveniently right inside that same sell zone. So it's pretty easy to see right now that if we can get up off these lows, I want to sell up here, right? But that brings now into the fourth component that we're seeing on this right now, and that is a rising support trend line. This might just be the biggest nightmare we can walk into tomorrow, right? Hopefully we can kind of break free of this, because obviously if I make a nice strong run higher right now and come collapsing back down, this is going to be difficult to get through that trend line, right? That trend line is not going to be very easy for sellers to get too excited about this, because they're not going to have a clear line of sight, right, to go back down to retest those lows. So that is a very important part, I think, of what we really have to worry about here for tomorrow. So four big components: overshoot of the channel, overshoot of the range. I love on that 93 resistance line, right? And of course, that support trend line as well. So now that we know kind of the big picture here, right? We know the buyers, they want to go back up and retest those major highs. If they can get control of this, right? Those buyers want to go back and retest those highs here. Let me get this back up here, right? Buyers would love to go back up and retest those highs, right? Sellers, of course, are sitting right at that 2695, right? That's that big bloodbath low. So they really can't get anywhere here without running into some major support and resistance. And of course, again, right, this is the 320 contract we're watching roll over here for tomorrow as well. So now that I zoom in on this, I got major support below me. I've got lots of resistance above me. I really don't want to be trading inside the range. That's my no trade zone. I've got my level of support down here, my levels of resistance above. All right, how do we trade this right now? The biggest problem, again, is going to be this trend line. If this trend line, if we can't make our way through it, the best possible scenario, honestly, would be if we can keep going sideways here, right, and get away and really break down that trend line. If I can get the trend line broken down, now what I can do is, if I can get this trend line broken down, I can get up, right, into my sell zone, up into that area of resistance. I can look for buyers now coming in, and I can look for a buyer failure to sell back down into that trading range. That would be the dream come true scenario here for us if we can get underneath that trend line, right? Or, you know, again, if it keeps on going sideways, then there really isn't any trend line any longer. We'll just simply wait for the pop. We'll wait for those bears to run out of bullets, as we always say. We'll wait for that moving average coming over. The buyers will likely try to buy that pullback and make a reversal out of it. Once they try to buy that pullback, that's when I know exactly where their stops are, and that's where I can look to sell back down into that trading range. So I'm looking for buyer failure patterns, basically, up inside my battle zone overhead. Now, I should also mention, too, this is a pretty wide battle zone, right? It's a pretty wide area here overhead. So, you know, if we get a relatively shallow pullback here, let me get this back up here again. I'm not sure why this keeps locking up on me here, but if we get this right, if we go sideways here, if we can get a relatively shallow pullback here, I can look for that buyer failure and go back down into that range. But if we really make a run up to that pendulum swing, if we really make a pretty strong run, again, we're assuming here that we go sideways for a bit. If we make a good strong run going higher here now that momentum is going to be a lot more difficult to fight. So in that situation, I'll look for what I call a nested failure, right? A one, a two, and then we'll look for that short coming back down. A lot of times, too, those nested failures, they end up really collapsing. And when they collapse, I always like to look for that two try trap pattern to finish off, right? To finish off that move as well. These are two setups I'm watching for if we get that, you know, if we reach that big pendulum swing, let's put it that way, right? If we reach that big pendulum swing all the way up top, that momentum will be relatively strong, right? It's not a bull market yet, but it'll be pretty strong up there. I'm going to want to see those buyers try twice now, and then I can sell it back down into that trading range. And again, you don't want to chase after it. Look for that two try trap pattern, right, to finish off the move as we go. So a quick recap on that, right? If we can get through the trend line, a shallow pullback is a straight up buyer failure pattern back into the range. A deep, deep pullback is a nested failure pattern. And those nested failures, they almost always turn into those two try trap patterns, right, as we go back down into the range. Now, don't forget, guys, I cover all of these patterns, all my favorite patterns, in my free trading classes. Got a great free trading course for you. I'll put a link in the upper right-hand corner for you there. Grab that free trading course, and you'll learn all about these patterns I'm talking about tonight in tonight's video. Now, of course, one of the most difficult parts about this is going to be if we stay around this trend line. This is where things are going to get challenging. What we're going to have to do is we're going to have to get a big pop, and we'll have to use traps. Whenever I have a rising support trend line, it really discourages a lot of sellers from getting aggressive. So I'm not gonna be able to use the straight, you know, the typical buyer failure pattern here, because I'm gonna be selling right into, right, that rising support. So I won't be able, you know, to use that, you know, that kind of the typical buyer failure pattern where we go up, the buyers try, and we sell into those stop losses back down again. What I wanna do in this situation is pretty much use one of those, what I call a crown reversal, which is we go up, we wait for the pullback to the moving average, we wait for the buyers to try to buy it. What I'll do is I'll wait for the failure, and I'll look for a trap off of the high. Technically, I call this a crown reversal pattern, right? This is one of those patterns that is very useful in these scenarios, because again, you're not gonna wanna sell into that level of support. And what happens a lot of times is, and we'll take a look at this on the oil market, right? Oil's pretty nasty here too. We'll take a look at this in a moment on oil. But usually if you've got that rising support trend line, you're gonna wanna get this thing, right, a trap above some sort of high to get that short, right, back down into that trading range. That's the biggest challenge I see here for the E-mini S&P as it goes higher. Now, obviously, a rising support trend line could easily, at this point now, result in a reversal. So what would a reversal look like here? How would we trade a reversal here? A reversal, first of all, needs to start off with strength. Once we have that strength move, then I look for a pullback to the moving average, and of course, a strong move off the moving average. Once I have that 1-2-3 reversal, as I call it, then I mark up the highs, I mark up the lows, I find that hidden channel, right? And that's gonna give me now should be a beautiful buy setup off the low of that channel. I call these 1-2-3 reversals, right? We're not gonna predict the reversal. We're not gonna buy that first pullback, but once they hold that pullback and they jump off the moving average, once they jump off the EMA, now I'm gonna grab that high, I'm gonna bring it down to that major low, find that hidden channel, and look to be a buyer right off of that low. Now, sometimes, right, sometimes the market doesn't pull back. You know, sometimes the market rips higher here. If it really races higher, I always like to look for that two-try trap. This is obviously not going to scale, obviously, but this is kind of the basic principle of that two-try trap pattern. These are oftentimes just below the moving average, and usually there's some sort of really narrow, you know, kind of hidden channel in there that you can buy off of those lows. This is a great pattern if we don't get that 1-2-3 reversal. So at this point now, like I said earlier, right, at this point, we've really got this thing planned out here. Either a 1-2-3 reversal into a hidden channel pullback, a two try trap if the market doesn't pull back but just rips higher, right? Again, if we go up above this, you know, again, above this trend line, I'm looking for a basically a crown reversal, right? It's kind of like a two-try trap. I'm just trying to stay away from selling into that trend line. And of course, if we do go sideways here, I can take a simple buyer failure, or if we really poke our head up, a nested failure, right, for that move back down. And again, as I mentioned before, that free trading class, right, linked up in the upper right-hand corner, make sure you get that registered here this afternoon. That way, when I talk about these patterns next time, you'll be able to see those in your mind and you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. Now, obviously, if we keep going sideways here, right, if we keep going sideways here, not a lot changes. What if the market goes lower though? Well, I think a lot of this has to do with how long we sit inside this range. If we sit inside this range for a good amount of time tomorrow, I have no problem buying off the low as long as I can get a nested failure. Nested failures are pretty simple, right? Once the market makes the run lower, I wait for the bears to try to sell it once. I wait for them to try to sell it twice. And once I've got them trying twice, I know where their stops are and I could buy right into those stop losses. It's the most reliable way to kind of pick a bottom, right, in a range-bound market. Now, if we don't sit inside the range and the market makes a run lower, now that momentum is a lot more impressive. And so for me to want to buy this market now, I'd have to break out the big guns now and look for a crown reversal. Crown reversals, of course, include a trap low, and that's why they're so much more reliable when we don't go sideways. I want to make sure it's very, very clear. If we go sideways, I can use that typical nested failure pattern. If we don't go sideways and we shoot lower, you've really got to be careful trying to call that bottom because that momentum will be very, very strong. I'll wait for those bears, try once, try twice, and again, the moving average will be coming right on through like that, right? Nice, strong green candle closing back above the moving average, and you're buying back up into that trading range. Now, I know what else you're thinking about, right? How do we get through this area, right, as we go? And where do we have targets on the way down? Now, again, we know we have that big major bloodbath low, right, from earlier on this week, right? That low that's keeping everyone up at night right now at certain financial companies, I'm sure. That 26.95 and a quarter low, I've got to get through that low on some serious strength. I've got another target down there. Really, the next big milestone is this 25.91. I would call it 2600, right? That's a good distance. We're sitting there just above 2700 right now. There's a lot of wide open space here, right, on the E-minis down to that 2600. Specifically, I've got 2691, 2679, and 2528 down there. But how do we trade as we're going down? Again, if we trade into that battle zone, it's a crown reversal, right, for a buy. If we make a run lower, it's a 1-2-3 break down, mark that low, find that hidden channel, and we're selling off the high of that hidden channel. Sometimes we don't get the pullback. Sometimes it just collapses and makes a run. If it just runs, right, just if it just falls apart here, watch for that shallow pullback, that lower low, and that trap high. We don't want to chase it, right? I do want to participate, obviously, if it's moving strong, but I don't want to chase it. And again, these will usually be right around some sort of very narrow, right, hidden channel there as we go. So again, it's a 1-2-3 break, basically breakout, right? 1-2-3, strong move down, hold that pullback, and then go, that will give me that green light now to draw my new channel and sell off the high of that channel. Or if we really bloodbath, shallow pullback, lower low, watch that trap high, right? And we'll sell it above the top right there. What I would imagine is we may see something like this where it runs and starts grinding lower. If that happens, mark up your channel, find the base of that channel, and that's usually going to be where your best entry will be from there. Well, we'll obviously talk more about this as we trade together, right, tomorrow morning, right? So, which reminds me, by the way, again, I'll put all the registration information. We get together and we trade this together every morning. I'll put all the registration information in the description of this YouTube video. So make sure you get started with the free course, right, or come out and trade it with me tomorrow as a member of our trade room, 8 o'clock Eastern time. So that's my plan as the market goes lower. I get a couple scenarios I'm watching for. I'm not opposed to buying off the low right now, but I do want to make sure I have the right entry pattern. And again, that nightmare of a trend line here could really make for either a full-blown reversal or possibly a very big headache for us tomorrow. If you know, a lot of times what happens is the market will go up and it'll kind of grind and chop and chop and chop, right? We may have to get underneath it, you know, in all reality, we may have to get up underneath it and use it as resistance on the other side too. I forgot to mention that earlier. There's a lot of things to talk about here on this S&P. So if it does run higher here, I don't want to sell into it, right? I can try to get underneath it and use it as resistance. As you can see, there's a lot of different plays that we can use on this. Let's keep this going though, because again, we're going to trade this together tomorrow. You know the basic idea right behind it at this point, and we'll of course make our way through it tomorrow morning in the trade room. How about some oil here tonight? How about some oil? Jumping into the oil market here this evening, the CL. Oil rollovers next week, by the way. So next week, we'll probably see rollover on oil the 17th or the 18th of the month. Now, this is a spike in channel example here on the oil right now. What do we know about oil? We know we have that bear move down. We know there was probably the most important thing here is a range. That's probably the most important clue on this chart. I can take that pendulum swing, the amount of the move below, the amount of the move above. I don't think you need it in this example. You'll see why in a moment. We know we're bearish. We know we want to be a seller on this. How do we sell this market tomorrow, right? We want to sell at resistance. So where would be the best levels of resistance here? Well, I've got my range. The size of that range determines my buy zones and my sell zones. So I can easily see I've got some great levels of resistance here overhead. I also like to draw those expanding triangles anytime I have a range. That will be a great level of resistance overhead as well, right? So we get a range, expanding triangle, lots of resistance levels here that I can use overhead. But I think the biggest clue though right now is this spike in channel. Strong move down, right? We get that lower low. I can draw that trend line off of those lows, right up to that high. That creates my spike in channel. That spike in channel is very important because, as we just talked about on the S&P, anytime I see a market make a nosedive and then run, I mark up that channel, and I know the base of that channel is where I want to be watching for, right? The base of that channel. So where is that on this chart? The base of that channel is right there, right? So that's pretty much the base of that channel where the channel runs into the spike, right? That's kind of the beginning of that channel. So that's going to be a very important spot here for us as well. So now we can really get a good feel for kind of how this market is, right? Where our key levels of resistance are going to be. The base of that channel, the top of that triangle, really up around this area, about, you know, around 34 here is where I want to be looking for the short side. Now, obviously, bears want to sell high. They want to go back down and retest those lows. If the market keeps going lower here, we've got that 30-13 level waiting down below us. 30-13 is the big objective for the bears. The bulls, of course, right? They're dreaming about getting back up to retest that 36-36 level here for tomorrow. Now, of course, if price pops higher, let's talk about this. I don't want to trade in the middle of the range. I want to buy low, sell high, avoid the middle in a range-bound market. What's the best way for me here to sell this? A lot of this has to do with whether or not, you know, we sit inside that range for a while. For example, if I go back into the range and I start going sideways here, that really absorbs a lot of the momentum in this market. And so now, once I get a pop higher, I can simply wait for a buyer failure into a bear pullback, right, and short back down into that range, right? This is a very common setup combination, a buyer failure into a seller pullback. It's pretty simple, right? If we sit inside the range for a while, that will absorb all momentum. When I see the market poke its head higher here now, buyers will undoubtedly assume this market has reversed and hope they do, because once they commit to buying off the moving average, I can now sell right into their stop losses. And of course, I always like to look for that pullback pattern, right, that follows up on it. Now, if we don't stall out inside the range, if we just make a run, you know, right back up to retest those highs now, I'm still at an area I want to pay attention to, but now that momentum is a lot more intimidating. Wouldn't you agree, right? At this point now, the best way to trade it now is to use that slightly more conservative, not a crown reversal, but that nested failure, right? That one try for the bulls, that two try for the bulls. I'd love to be underneath this trend line, although it's not required. I would like to see one, two try from the buyers here. Once I see that, then I know exactly where their pain points are. I know exactly where they start getting out of their positions, and we'll just simply place our sell orders right there to sell right into those stop losses. Now, every once in a while, we see a two-legged pullback, a lot like we just talked about on the S&P, where, of course, we draw that trend line up. I'll try to get underneath it and use it as resistance on the other side. We call these two-legged pullback patterns. And I'll tell you, two-legged pullback patterns happen a lot more than you might think. And we talk a lot about those two-legged pullback patterns in that free trading class I keep mentioning. That link, by the way, is in the upper right-hand corner. If you're not going to trade with me tomorrow as a client, the next best thing is to grab that free course linked up in the upper right-hand corner, and you'll learn a lot more about those two-legged pullbacks. Now, obviously, if we get a strong move higher, and if those buyers can hold this pullback and make a run, this now becomes a full-blown reversal. I'm not trying to predict that pullback holding, but once I see it hold and I see it run, now I can mark up the high, I can mark up that low now, and now I can look for that pullback to buy that pullback, right? These are called 1-2-3 reversals into hidden channel pullbacks. Now remember, sometimes these markets don't pull back and they just rip higher, right? If this thing just rips higher here, shallow pullback, higher high, trap low, right? Remember that? Trap low. That's the key to this one. And again, these will usually be just below the moving average. Usually can find a little hidden channel there somewhere, right, and grab that long, right, the buy off that low. Look closely how this pattern looks, right? It's a higher high in price. Usually what happens is it's a shallow pullback that is not pulled back to the moving average. And that higher high that follows is the giveaway that, okay, buyers are gonna be waiting right below that low. What I always do is I always look left and try to find some trend line out here, trying to line it up. And if I see it really coming off that low, that new hidden channel, it's a full boat position on that one. That's a very good setup. Again, we've got to get that big, strong momentum push though, real strong up front, or it's 1-2-3, big strong jump up, mark the high, mark the low, and we're off for the races, right, buying as we go. So those are a couple scenarios we're watching for here as the market goes higher. Now, if we sit here going sideways, not a lot changes. I'm looking to sell with buyer failures up above. Can I buy? I mean, if we sit here for a while, make a run going lower, can I buy the low here? You definitely can, but you want to make sure you use that nested variation, right? That is a 1, a 2, and then go, right? Obviously, if we just made a nosedive down and didn't care about that range, I would not use that nested. I would use my crown reversal. But I would say right now, though, without any support down here, you want to be careful with crown reversals. You know, reversal patterns are great when you have a market that is A, overextended, B, at a key level of support, and C, gives you those two tries with a trap low, in this case, right, from those sellers, right? My biggest concern would be Yes, I can definitely look for a crown reversal here, right? I could definitely look for a crown reversal there. That's great, right? Because I'm at a level of support, right? I'm at the low of the channel. I'm below the low of that range. However, if we make a run going lower, all bets are off on that. I would not try to pick the bottom on that move going lower. Now, as we do try to go lower, right? We know where we're trying to go. We're trying to get that 30-13 level we mentioned earlier here. 1, 2, 3, break down, mark the low, mark the high, right? Short off the high of that hidden channel, or strong move down, shallow pullback, lower low, trap high. Remember these, right? Two tried traps here. Again, they'll usually be just above that moving average. Mark that low, mark that high. Keep an eye out for that hidden channel there. That'll be a nice setup for us as we go lower here as well. And, you know, also too, right, a lot of times we do see spike in channels turn into new spike in channels. So if we do get a market that makes a nosedive down, starts tumbling lower, stay calm, stay patient, and wait for, you know, right, you know, wait for that pop. That pop will usually come up. The buyers will usually think this thing has reversed. They'll try to buy off the pullback, and you can sell right into their stop losses for a buyer failure pattern. Spike in channel patterns are very, very common when markets get spooked. So definitely keep an eye out for that as we go lower. So really at this point, a lot of this has to do with how this market spends the next couple hours, right? Do we go back into the range and chop? I can be a lot more aggressive selling off the highs with that, or do we rip back higher here? I really got to stay patient with a nested failure pattern, right, to sell short there before we might see a full-blown reversal. Again, don't forget all the registration links for tomorrow morning's trading session. I'll put all the info for you in the description of the YouTube video, and don't forget to grab that free trading course linked up in the upper right-hand corner. Next up here, let's grab the gold here, the yellow metal. Gold is going to be a tricky one here for tomorrow. Gold has potential. If you were with me today in the trade room on the S&P, we saw how the S&P kept hanging out on that overnight low. This is a very challenging spot here. The S&P is challenging because it's got that rising support trend line. Gold definitely looks challenging right now because of this 42.5 area, that big, big low, right, they keep on bouncing off of, right? So my biggest problem is not direction, that's for sure. What do we know about gold right now? We know that gold continues to rotate inside this channel. It's pretty easy to see, right? You can see that pretty much a mile away here. This is the same channel from last night, right? We talked about this last night. Our job was to sell off the high of that channel. The strategy was perfect, right? If you follow it from last night's newsletter. Now here we are. We're at the low of that channel, right? But there's one very big difference between today's move and yesterday's move. Yesterday's move was kind of a lazy, you know, so yeah, we'll get there when we get there to a move here. This was almost a straight line down, right? A very strong bear run, which tells me we may not get a full rotation back up to the high of that channel. This is where momentum really comes into play, because when you have a really wide channel like this, right? Wide channels are great because the market will rotate back and forth. However, what happens is most of the time when the market rotates, it's going to kind of bounce, right? It'll bounce and bounce and bounce. Well, if it rotates down and goes straight down like this, right? Most of the time they'll kind of stair step down, right? Today though, what happened? It went pretty much straight down. And a lot of times when it goes straight down like that, it gets stuck. And it kind of grinds down here like this, right? Almost like it turns into its own spike in channel. The reason I'm mentioning this is don't hold your breath tomorrow for a move back up to the high of that wide channel. When I was a rookie, I used to always struggle with this because I was so locked in to selling the high of the channel. You know, when you're a relatively new trader, you've got these black and white rules. I'm only going to sell the high of the channel. But the problem is, if we get a real strong momentum move like we just saw on gold, we just probably aren't going to get that pop back up to the high of that big wide channel. So when I look at this chart, it's easy to see where we are with the lows here, but you can see that big move down. So I'm going to go in and put another channel on here and really focus on trying to get short up around the high of that channel. If we get a gift and we do get a big pullback, to the high of the big channel, then consider it a gift from the trading gods. But this much strength here, that is kind of the one thing that stands out here right now, is we may not get that full-blown pullback right as we go. So we know we're bearish. We know we had a very strong move down. That tells me don't anticipate that much of relief off of these lows, and I've got to be ready, right, for really a shallow pullback. That leads me into now what I think is the biggest challenge, which is that 42 half area. Because a lot of times what will happen is that's the previous low, right, that bloodbath low here, right, from the gold. Now, and we saw this today, there was the overnight low on the S&P and the market got stuck right above it. What I've done here is I've got this new channel marked up. I like this new channel, and I would love to sell off that high. I love the little trap up there. That's where I would love to be a seller. The problem is if I can get that pullback, look where I'm at now. Now I'm right into that level of resistance. And what happens a lot of times is the market will sit there and sit there and sit there, and eventually nobody can break through it. It'll pop higher. And you've got to wait for that pop and then sell into the buyer failure, right? It's like a buyer failure pattern after it pops. This is not going to be easy. A lot of times it gets really bloody around that low. And again, I keep referencing the S&P 500. We saw that happen today, right? The overnight low, right? What happens is you've got that overnight low, right? The market made that big dip in the overnight here. It came back, went below it. We come in at 8 o'clock this morning, the market pops right back up, and it just sits there, right? And it sits there. And it wasn't until we got a little bit off that high, right, off that level, that's where bears came in and said, nice, double it up, hit me, right? And they sold it back down again. So you've got to be waiting up above, and obviously I don't know how big that little range will be, but we've got to be willing to sell above that high here. It's the only way we're going to be able to do it. So hopefully, if I can get these, if it pulls back here in the short term, we'll be sitting above that level. I've got that trend line overhead, so hopefully we can get this thing to kind of poke its head higher, get that moving average up. I can look for that buyer failure off the EMA. You know, it'll look a lot like that, right? It'll poke its head higher. The buyers will try to buy off the moving average. It'll collapse back down, right? That same idea we'll look for over here, right? So look for that basically it's a buyer failure off that high, off resistance, a good distance away from that again, that kind of pre-low, that prior, right, major swing low at 42 half. Now, the gift to us, right, talk about trading gods giving us gifts, would be if this thing could roll lower here for me, then I can actually use that, right, that 42 half as a key level of resistance, right? So that would really be the absolute kind of best possible scenario here for these sellers, right? If I could get this thing to kind of cruise lower here, I still have that channel overhead. Now what I want to do is wait for that pop, right? Maybe we get to the measured move waiting down here, major support. Get that, right? Get that pop up off that low now. And usually what happens is once we reach a measured move, you get some profit taking. The profit taking gets confused for reversal. The buyers try to buy the pullback. Now we know where their stops are. Now we've got them right where we want them, right? Now we've got a level of resistance, and now I can sell into those stops from there with a pretty easy, at that point, right, pretty easy buyer failure pattern to short that baby back down. At that point, it's the retest of that measured move. Now, another potential scenario here is we make a run lower and we sit at that measured move, right? That could easily happen too. It could just kind of sit there on that measured move. That's fine too. Just make sure you focus on selling above the range. My favorite pattern in a range environment is a buyer failure. We wait for the poke its head higher. We wait for those buyers to come in and try to buy that pullback. Once the buyers buy off the pullback, now we know where the stops are and we can sell into those stops from there. Now, with that said, right, what if we poke our head higher here? And again, as we go, right, as we go higher here, if we go higher, we can't sell into that low. It's not reliable. So we sit, we poke our heads up. The buyers try to reverse it. They fail. We sell into their failure. What happens if they run up? We hold the pullback and we jump. That's a reversal. Mark up the high, mark up the major low, that creates your hidden channel, and That would honestly be just as easy, right? So it's either we get a reversal or we get this market to keep going lower. I don't care what direction I trade, and hopefully you don't either, right? I realize it's sometimes difficult to ignore the news media, and they make us so scared about this stuff right now, right? But we got to focus on the charts, focus on the short-term momentum. If I can get a 1-2-3 reversal, right, I'm all good to buy that pullback. That sounds great. In fact, it'd be probably a pretty good trade too, because you got that high just waiting to be tested. Or if it starts ripping higher as we go here, right? This thing really races higher here, shallow pullback, higher high. Once you see that higher high, now you know. Now you know you're gonna probably get that trap low right off of that low. That's usually a pretty darn good reliable trade. You might be wondering too though, what if we sliced higher here? Could I use a crown reversal? You definitely could too. If it really pushes and we can get away from that level of support, now watch the difference here. The difference is a crown reversal is a lower high, not a higher high, right? We go up, shallow pullback, higher high, that's a two-try trap waiting to set up. Okay, so no higher high here. If we get a lower high now we know we've got a concern about support, and anytime we have a concern about support, what do? Trap patterns. Right? Trap patterns. Traps are our go-to here. We got to find some trap to get above some prior swing so we can safely get in short. And again, think of it this way, right? Buyers try once, buyers try twice. And again, all you're doing is you're trying to set the table for a trap, right? Strong move up, one try for the buyers, two try for the buyers. Trap high, plenty of room to go down to that low. Right? Trap patterns, by the way, are my favorite setups when I'm trying to avoid selling into support or buying into resistance. And again, I cover all the stuff on the traps inside the free trading course, and we do a lot of work with traps every morning in our trade room. Get registered for tomorrow's trading session in the description of this YouTube video. One more possible scenario here would be we go sideways down here. You know, I wouldn't mind that either. You know, if it goes sideways here, sits here for a while, that wouldn't be horrible, because that would really dilute the effectiveness of that 42.5. At that point now, at that point, once we know our size of our range, that will tell me now where my resistance level is. You know, we might also have like a little expanding triangle here too. I can get above it, right? So if we start going sideways here, I'll obviously start looking for right that range. Once I get that range here, now we want to get up above the range, get those moving averages up, buyers will come in, and this will all depend on kind of how close we're going to be to that low, right? I may have to use a trap high, right, to avoid selling into that low, right? Or we make it something, right, a little more forgiving. We may see it run up. We may see a buyer, right, failure a lot higher up on that ladder. So it really has a lot to do with kind of where we are in relationship to it. I wish I could give you some more definitive information on this, but a lot of that range will depend on how wide the range is and kind of where we go from there. And again, watch out as we go lower here, because we got that measured move waiting as we go lower here. If I can get through it, right, with a 1-2-3, we're on to the downside, right? Find that new low, keep selling off that high, or if it dumps as we go, right? Lower low, shallow pullback, trap high for that two-try trap pattern. The next objective down is that 1600 if we can get through that measured move as we go here. So we got all the bases covered here for us, right? We know exactly how to buy this market. We know how to sell it. We know how difficult that 42.5 area is going to be for tomorrow. And hopefully I'll see you with me tomorrow morning, right? Live in real time, 8 o'clock Eastern time. We're going to go out and do this together. We do every morning. Don't forget, guys, I'll put all the links for tomorrow morning's trading session. If I can put this on the website there, right? I'll put all the links in the description of this YouTube video. So make sure you get registered as a new member and come out and trade with me tomorrow morning as a client. If membership isn't quite right yet for you, don't forget our free trial includes that free trading course. You'll learn all about our favorite patterns. Don't be afraid to give me a call here in the office. I'll be here for the rest of the evening. Please feel free to give me a call if you have any questions. I can also help walk you through getting registered for tomorrow morning's trading session over the phone. And also too, we got live support. Don't be afraid to use that live support tool as well. So a lot of tricks up our sleeves for tomorrow. The S&P has that trend line. Gold has that prior swing. oil has that beautiful crown reversal. We are looking forward to another great day tomorrow. I hope I see you there with me. If not, come back and see me again in tomorrow night's newsletter. And as always, my name is Joseph. Be well out there. Be nice to each other, will you? And be here next time. Adios, amigos. Bye-bye for now.